सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन इन लंदन. सो ऑन अ क्लोज रीडिंग ऑफ द टाइटल ऑफ द नॉवल सजेस्ट दैट इट इज ऑल्सो अबाउट, इट इज नॉट जस्ट अबाउट अ वुमेन अक्वायरिंग अटेनिंग अ काइंड ऑफ सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन, इट इज ऑल्सो अबाउट द लाइफ ऑफ पीपल who are discriminated against in a foreign country where they are treated as secondary citizens. So they it is against it is about the segregation and prejudice faced by Africans in United Kingdom and their homogenization into a single category of coloreds, also the inferior position of African women in their own country. So in a way it deals with at least three types of marginalization. First, it is the segregation and prejudice of Africans in United Kingdom. Second, it is the inferior position, marginalized position of African women in their own society. They are second class humans, considered as second class humans in their own society. And third, in a very subtle manner, the novel shows how some people yield to the stereotypes that they are associated with by the whites. In this process, they internalize the inferior position that the white society relegates them to and resigns them to the role of second class citizens. So the third point is what I am going to interrogate in the paper. So this paper takes recourse to the trope of blackness to study how a few characters in the novel, second class citizen, deal with it during their stay in the United Kingdom. So the trope of blackness is what I am going to examine here. So as we see, there are at least two kinds of characters. First of all are the ones who give in to the notion of blackness, give in to the notion of color prejudice that surrounds them. And in the second category is primarily Ada, who doesn't want to internalize that inferior position which is imposed on her being a black woman. So in the first category is her husband, Francis. Her husband, Francis, who almost tries to internalize that position of blackness and the color, second class citizen, the position of being a second class citizen in the country, in London. For example, in one instance, he tells Ada that the restaurants in England are for whites only. The blacks should not go to the restaurants. But Ada, on the other hand, thinks the opposite. She thinks that the restaurants are not only meant for the whites, but if there is money, if she has the money, then she also has the equal right to visit the restaurant. So in a way, she tries to resist that label of second class citizen being imposed on her. Secondly, we see that in another instance, Ada tries again to resist that notion, the notion that black mothers do not keep their children with themselves, but they have to depend on registered babysitters for the upbringing of her babies. So in London, it was the norm at that time that the black mothers have to give the children to be fostered by white mothers. So the white women would foster the children, would rear up the children in return of some money. So this was the norm because the black women rarely got the time to look after her own children, because she also had to work outside. She also had to earn. This was the case with Ada too. So first of, in the initial phase, she obliged. She gave her children Titi and Vicky into the custody of a babysitter named Trudy. However, a serious sickness engulfed Vicky, and the negligence of Trudy in the case compelled her to bring her children back to her. So here she demystifies another myth that black mother cannot keep her children with her own, or she cannot get proper nursery places for her children, which are meant for the whites. So as soon as she protests, she comes out of the label of being tagged as a second class citizen. So she has claimed for herself a space which was confined to the white whites or the first class citizen in America. So in a way, her blackness, her being colored, does not stand in the way of achieving or acquiring equal rights for herself and for her children. So in another instance, we see that Ada, unlike her husband Francis, does not believe in the superiority of only one language, that is English. Her husband, on the contrary, Francis, that is, he wants his children to speak only in English. So much so that Titi, the elder daughter of them, she stops speaking in any language. She stops her speech altogether. She doesn't speak at all because of the compelling demands made by her father that she should speak only in English. But it is not the case with Ada. She does not let herself be robbed of her Igbo identity. She is an Igbo, a tribe belonging to Africa. So she can speak the African languages. Excuse me.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but time is going on. So
It's okay. So in the novel, the notion of blackness plays out in different ways for different characters. While primarily all the characters somehow subscribe to the fact that owing to their color, they have to face discrimination and they accept it as inevitable. Ada has a different outlook on her being black. For her, it is not inferior. The color is not inferior. We see in towards the last ending part of the novel that when her fourth child Sunshine is born, she is almost taken in by the beauty of her child. She calls her a black doll. So she finds no shame in her color or in the fact that she or her babies are black, all of whom would now live and grow in the white country, the United Kingdom. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Das. Now I would like to invite Professor S. Bhanupriya to present her paper. The paper is on an overview of African culture and orature with reference to Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart.
Thank you.
Professor Bhanupriya, are you there?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Please start. Yes, you're audible.
Thank you. Myself, Bhanupriya, Assistant Professor of English, Kalasalingam Academy of Research and Education, Tamil Nadu. My topic is an overview of African culture and literature with reference to Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. Literature has its main thrust in explaining what literature is as a field of study is all about, together with its usefulness of mankind. Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart is an incredible hallmark of African literature for several reasons. First of all, it possesses the situations and problems which are associated with the colonization of Africa and its impact on African culture and society. The novel also illustrates various literary stereotypes and shows how even Western stereotypes or archetypes can be found in African literature. Moreover, the novel presents to Western readers a good sense of African language and its euphemisms while still being quite readable and enjoyable. More importantly, the novel presents a vivid illustration of African culture. African culture has only recently become more literate since it was primarily an oral culture. Oral culture is a cultural component that distills the essence of human experiences, shaping them into rememberable, readily retrievable images of broad applicability with an extraordinary potential for eliciting emotional responses. Its epics, epigrams, poems, songs, and folktales were all spoken and recited until more recent times when literary becomes more prevalent and African culture was revitalized. African novels, especially Achebe's, become the new prominence and proponent of African culture, African oral culture especially. This particular novel is full of Achebe's native Igbo oral tradition, and such is the topic of this paper also. African oratory portrayed in Things Fall Apart, a society where oratory is greatly valued. The Igbos believe that a man can manifest his power through oratory. The great orators of Umuofia can impress everyone with their vast knowledge of proverbs and tales. At the very beginning of the novel, Igbos are presented as great orators with the ability to persuade and convince people. Orators are greatly admired in Igbo society. On one occasion, Ogiebu, the orator, succeeds in igniting the suppressed anger of Umuofians over the murder of an Umuofian woman by the men of the neighboring village called Mabana. Another incident that we can quote is the Achwif Igbo has a highly developed system of religion which worked as effectively as the Christian religion. Both Christianity and Igbo religion approve morality, honesty, straightforwardness, and respect for the God. Celebration of marriage and love, Achwif society as a culture. Achwif also celebrates marriage and love in his Things Fall Apart. So marriage has been an age-long celebration. This is therefore equality between men and women. Achwif Igbo society consequently admires equality between men and women. As a result, men like Ojepu of Ir village who respect their wives are revered, while men like Lokno, who prefers to beat their wives even in pregnancy, are represented as portrayed in these words. They celebrate art, music, poetry, everything in their culture. He portrays his Igbo culture and society, which flourishes on the pillars of art, music, and poetry. It is common to decorate walls and bodies at ceremonies. Even hair is shaved in beautiful patterns. Stories are didactic and moralistic as they teach about the gods and passing on the culture to the younger generation. Okay, to conclude my paper, I will say that African writers control the colonial tongue by altering the linguistic features of such languages. Specifically, Achwif manipulates the English language in his Things Fall Apart to present the Igbo culture and the society as splendid but not without the cultural storms which should be purged in order to embrace modernity. So Achwif Igbo society knows that change and progress are needful and indispensable. Throughout the novel, Achwif has given a very good portrayal of the culture and the oratory of African society, which has been a very prolonged practice as old as the African culture. That's what my presentation is. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bhanupriya.
Thank you, sir.
So here's a message for all the participants. If you have any questions for the speakers, you can just post your questions on the chat box, and speakers are kindly requested to try to answer those questions. So if you have any questions, please write it down on the chat box. So up next, I would like to call Ms. Steffi Kunjuman, student of MA in English Language and Literature, Mar Ivanius College, Trivandrum. And she has got a very interesting topic. It's a very unconventional one. And being a Marvel comic fan, it fascinates me. Afro-American representation in the movies Black Panther and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, an exploration of the Afrofuturism, Black Pride, and counter-narrative and perspectives. So, Steffi, are you there? Hello. Steffi Kunjuman, are you there? Please unmute yourself. Steffi Kunjimon, are you there?
She doesn't seem to be there, sir.
Okay, so we'll move on. So up next, I would like to invite Professor Neela P.U., Assistant Professor, Department of English, the Zamorins, Guru Vayappan College, Calicut, Kerala. Her topic is considering the different facets of African children's stories. Professor Neela P.U., are you there?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I intend to brief on the contents of my paper titled Considering the Different Aspects of African Children's Stories. South Africa, a continent where national borders were arbitrarily created by colonial powers, South African literature has emerged out of a long tradition of resistance amidst conflicts and confusions. Many communities surfaced in course of time, interwoven to form a creolized society, and also the oral and written literatures began to flourish. The legacy of African-American children's literature traced back to the late 1800s, stimulated a liberating change with the Brownies books. It is said that this book, the Brownies books, holds with it the purpose to make black children familiar with the history and achievements of Negro race, and also to realize that being colored is quite a normal thing. There are many classic books which relate to the citizenship, nation, education, environment, etc. These books focus on the ways in which the society, societal influences, education in and outside, inside and outside schools can be used to mold the character, personality, and also to promote the individual growth of children. There are also books which bring forth the themes which intend to inculcate empathy, feelings, compassion, and also themes which point to family, books of cultural relevance, etc. Some stories, spirituality is another important factor. There are stories emphasizing on spirituality. I happened to read an article on African children's literature, spirituality and climate change. In that article, it is said that even though spirituality is seen employed as a major theme in African children's stories, it does not suggest pessimism. Some stories reveal that in order to solve certain challenges in life, practical interventions are seen engaged, but at the same time, there are instances which emphasize on appealing to spiritual forces. Children are encouraged to question life in general, actually. And in traditional African communities, elders play a pivotal role in inducing spiritual thoughts in young people through means of folk tales, myths, and so on. By narrating stories adorned in colorful exaggeration that prompts children to fantasize the whole event. This is likely to enable them to associate history and culture. Folk tales, to a great extent, help children to generate a positive attitude towards the environment. Environment is another theme. Her nature is personified, it is treated as divine. This strengthens the sense of reverence and or respect in children towards their environment, thereby invoking environmental consciousness within them. The natural environment and wildlife have been a focus to most of African children's stories. Many books express ecological concerns as a focus of the plots. Now, there are also fantasy stories which portray children fighting against the forces that threaten the environment. A parent says she makes sure her children's... she makes sure her
Ma'am, please fix your microphone in a proper way. You're not audible.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, it's okay now.
Okay. I'm sorry for that. a black parent, she says she makes sure her children's library is full of books featuring protagonists of color. According to her, this helps them to perceive things that make them feel similar and different. The value of representation is significant here. And these type of stories explore themes like empathy, cultural pride, empowerment, etc. Next is the physical appearances and attire. While talking about the physical appearances and attire in African children's stories, it is evident that authors have mentioned about the physical differences in their stories. Nudity is also another aspect. Nudity is, it is remarked as well. False envy of black children's nudity continued in many stories. So when we think of the advent of children's literature, it is said that at some time in the 17th century, society became conscious about childhood. That is, childhood as a period during which special care should be given to children, or to realize that this period demands certain special needs. Thus, for educational purposes of reading, triggered the evolution of children's literature, and it became an effective means for imparting education for children. Evidently, there have been transformations and notions of childhood and children's culture. These transformations or these changes can be seen as a the representations of these changes can be seen in the representations of various aspects in children's books. In the so-called children's stories, we can also see that the culture confirms itself. These stories can be seen as a cultural reproduction of the relationship between adult and child. And as these black stories are written by adults, we can see that the children's stories written by adults, we can see that the different depictions are from an adult perspective. Thus, the study is a small attempt to explore the varying factors employed in the children's stories. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And now I would like to call upon Neha Shaw. I would like to request Neha Shaw, Department of English, Rishi Bankim Chandra College, to deliver a speech, present a paper. Neha, are you there? Neha Shaw. Neha, are you there? Neha, if you are present, please unmute yourself.
There is one Neha present, but I'm not sure if she's Neha Shao.
Neha, if you're present, please unmute yourself. Neha Shao, Department of English, Rishi Bankim Chandra College. Neha Shao.
I don't think she's here, sir. We shall move to the next speaker.
Okay. So, we are moving on to the next speaker. Now, I would like to request Neha T.V., M.Ed. Scholar of Central University of Kerala, Department of Education. I would like to request her to present her paper, and her paper is on African literature and culture. Ma'am, are you there? Neha T.V. Neha TV, are you there?
Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Good evening, all. My topic is African literature and culture. The study of the development of African literature leads to various reflections on the future continent and its population. Self-knowledge and consciousness of one's culture identity are two major factors in the process of affirmation of one's personality. To share these values with the other continents of the globe is essential for the Africans whose culture and civilization have been denied or rejected during many centuries. African literature is literature of Africa and includes oral literature. As George Joseph notes in his chapter on African literature in Understanding Contemporary Africa, whereas European views of literature often stressed a separation of art and content, African awareness is inclusive. Literature can also simply mean an artistic use of words for the sake of culture alone. Traditionally, Africans do not radically separate art from teaching African literature teaching. African literature consists of a body of work in different languages and various genres, ranging from oral literature to literature written in colonial languages. Literature like orature, as coined by the Uganda scholar Pio Sirimu, is influenced by culture, which is the pivot upon which societies are urged. Pre-literature societies, which by definition are devoid of any written literature, are enriched by the varied oral traditions, folk epics, folklore, proverbs, and folk song. It is the combination of this which is regarded as oral literature or orature. Literate societies, though heavily relying on the written word, tap into folkloric traits through bedtime stories or other informal social gatherings, urban legends, jokes, oral and performance poetry. The aesthetic of African literature conforms to cultural truths and aspirations cherished by a community: morality, honesty, hard work, chastity and unity as ingredients of societal cohesion should be central to the stories that are passed on from one generation to another. The reverse vices are the truths that inform society to be on guard, as individuals are tempted to use the cunning and the selfish inclinations to hold the entire community at ransom. The use of animal characters, song, the journey, which the modern storyteller fears into using the strict trope, has always been used to lambast the nature of man. He seeks to consolidate his selfish hold on others. It is this influence that orature has on the written word in its exposure and castigation of vice, which has prompted at the bookstore or to previous yesteryear. Yeah, it is this same here that litters folkloric drama, which perverts African literature today as man struggle to release himself from his own grip in a mirror of his own creation, which he so much wants to blame on others. Modern African literature were born in the educational systems imposed by colonialism, which with models drawn from Europe rather than existing African traditions. So the true African culture, literature, and the development is, objectively speaking, the African culture and literature is still undocumented. When one looks closely at the daily lives of ordinary Africans, one is bound to come out with some benchmarks of what true African literature and culture can be. The total way of life of the ordinary African can be stories, drama, art, and so on are dominated by communal values, sharing, cooperation dominate. These values are reflected in their interaction with each other, song and dance. Thank you.
Thank you, Neha TV, for your presentation. Now, I would like to request Professor Nidhi Meshram for presenting her paper on setting and breaking the stereotypes in Marriage is a Private Affair, sentient narration.
Am I audible, sir? Thank you.
Yes, am you're absolutely audible. You're okay. Absolutely audible.
Thank you. Yeah. Respected chairperson, fellow paper presenters and participants, a warm good afternoon. I, Nidhi Meshram, Assistant Professor, Department of English, LAD and Srimati RP College for Women, Nagpur, Maharashtra State, would be presenting a paper titled Setting and Breaking the Stereotypes in Marriage is a Private Affair, a Sentient Narration. It is an attempt to discuss the human thoughts, feelings, emotions that is experienced by all of us. But these feelings, thoughts, emotions are focused with context to marriage. Though there are several dimensions like theology or post-colonial influence, my paper has not touched any such aspects, but deals simply with the emotions that I feel has engulfed predominantly throughout the story. Similarly, I have not actually used quotes defining social psychology or supportive sociological theories, as I felt that the dialogues and thoughts expressed more lucidly the emotions, feelings that needs no elaborative description, as experience is more important. Well, talking about the story, Chinua Achebe's short story, Marriage is a Private Affair, is a strong and effective narrative subtly reflecting on the effects of marriage as an institution. The intensely woven story skillfully reveals the human psyche, the social norms set forth in the name of customs, showing the integrity of sections that transforms itself from the local colors of an African setup into a universal approach that is so very watertight to maintain and achieve social recognition and existence. The conflict between the two generations exemplifies the staunch belief of each individual to adhere to the restricted norms laid forth by society to uphold a lucrative position in the community that they live in. The institution of marriage has been effectively showcased by Chinua Achebe that encompasses the paraphernalia associated with individuals who strive hard to maintain a make-believe persona surrounding their own self. The struggle of each character in the story unravels the plight that further leads them to self-understanding and brings forth the humanitarian approach towards the end, propagating a healthy Eden. My attempt is to use or speculate the theory of social psychology and sociological aspects pertaining to the emotions that human beings exponentially experience. Today, when the entire world is a witness to honor killing, this masterpiece is a reflective of all man-made barriers under the pretext of customs, traditions, and cultures. It rightfully deconstructs the set norms enforced upon common men, compelling its readers to contemplate the prominence of human feelings, emotions, sentiments, etc., in choosing a partner for lifelong companionship. I have divided my paper into three subsections. The first being impact of social dominance. Looming through the rural and urban setup into the conscious and inner mind of the characters, the story further sets to concretize the ubiquitous reality that deftly brings the entire world woven with one common thread of social consciousness that at times distances the family members into oblivion consciously. The conservative societies that exist in the man-made world is a small representation in the form of the Igbo tribe that strictly does not allow marriages outside its clan. The impact of social dominance is evident especially through the two male characters around whom the story moves about. As we all know that the story opens with dialogue between a young couple, Nemeka and Nene, it further elaborates that the conversation portrays a built-up tension between the father and son regarding the issue of marriage of the young educated son, who has already chosen a girl for himself, and she happens to be a working class teacher teaching at a girls' school. But the son tells his father that she is a good Christian. The strict demarcation of thought between the son and the father is existent in a few exchange of dialogues that they hold with each other throughout the story. And these particular feelings that they exchange between the two indicates that the feelings are indicative of a father's governing role as a parent who has raised the son and made him independent, but does not grant independence in practical sense by letting him choose wife of his own choice, which incidentally is one of the most crucial decisions of one's life. The social impact of morally balanced and compliant person is to adhere to elders' thoughts and customs is rigidly observed by Okeke, the father, who completely ignores that education also brings in the freedom of thought process and logical reasoning. This expectation of nurturing an obedient and non-rebellious son is the outcome of the impact of social dominance that is showcased adeptly through the character of the father. He as well inadvertently falls prey to the rigid established thought of bonding relations between two families from the same clan through marriage, which is suggestive to furnish its solidarity and a display of conservative ideology. Similarly, the stereotypical belief that is infused within the social hierarchical arrangement into the mind of females is that they solely and crucially can knit societies together. They have to be submissive, dependent, and docile. Whatever comes their way has to be accepted and not questioned. Nene Etan is portrayed just the opposite of these set norms or notions and is a qualified teacher who chose her own life partner and a career. She still shows her shades of characteristics that are predominantly suggestive of the impact of social dominance to enter into a fairy tale bond of structure imposed through marriage. Nevertheless, she expects happiness throughout, which is more humanistic than gender specific. The second subtopic that I have, context that I have taken is setting the stereotype. And these setting of the stereotypes I have restricted only to OKK, the father. Well, the writer engages his reader into the formal framework of the social settings in order to be acceptable to the society, but inherently adhering to the customs and standards laid down by the past generations, the father OKK does not seem to be erroneous. His behavior and action by not accepting Nene as his family member, owing to the prejudice he has against her being a non-Igbo and a school teacher, finds solid support from his clan members. He is their role model who exemplifies a structured behavior and reaction to the crisis that his educated son has brought upon him. His response is influenced by the social environment that he has been brought up, and obviously this generates a close study of social psychology. For almost 8 years, he consciously forgets his father, son and his family, as his loyalty rests towards the village and villagers who have been brought who have been together with each other through thick and thin times. The blasphemous offense that his son committed does not put OKK in a negative shape of their thoughts, that is the villagers' thoughts, as he openly opposes his son's decision. I shall just conclude. My third subsection was that of breaking the stereotypes. But to conclude, marriage is a private affair, refuses to believe that it is Satan's work. These lines are from the text itself, or it is the beginning of the end. Due to self-introspection and staunch belief in human existence and understanding on compassionate grounds, marriage indeed is a private affair wherein the partners contemplate a bright future, taking into consideration all facilities and restrictions that can surpass all the hurdles, but include society as an active contributor towards a fruitful future. The narrative reiterates that all the sections created by man are basically for man and his development, and to conclude with Aristotle's belief that humans were naturally sociable, a necessity which allows us to live together, finally comes true at the end of the story, dangling the thread of optimism universally. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So here's an announcement for all of the participants. If you really have any question upon any topic, please write it down on the chat box, and I would like to request the speakers to answer those questions over there. So the next speaker is Nidhi Vora, a student of PG English, fourth semester, Rishi Bankim Chandra College. Nidhi has been a very serious and sincere student in my class. So today she will be presenting her paper in Double Consciousness, a Theory, a Practice with Reference to Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye. Nidhi, you can start.
Thank you, sir. Just a minute, I'll start with my presentation. Is my PPT visible, sir?
Yes, your PPT is visible. Start.
Yes, sir, 1 second. So the title of my paper is Double Consciousness, a Theory, a practice with reference to Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye. Racism refers to a belief that a group or community possess a trait which is different in terms of physical appearance. Racism in Africa has been operating since several centuries. The one facing such discrimination goes through various trauma and trouble which leaves him as the other, a stranger in his society. The person then becomes conscious so much that he tries to behave like the one who is supposedly superior to him, and in doing so loses his own identity. In 2020, let's remember, racism is wrong and treat everyone equally. However, our main focus in this paper remains on the concept of double consciousness. The term double consciousness refers to the inner conflict which occurs within the colonized section of an oppressive society. The term was first coined by William Edward Bogart Du Bois in his 1897 work, The Souls of Black Folk, where he described the double consciousness of African American, which also included his personal experience. Double consciousness is a psychological process in which the colonized goes through the experience of looking at oneself through the eyes of others and measuring oneself with the notion that is prevailing in the society. Similarly, Frantz Fanon too touched this concept in his first work, Black Skin, White Mask, where he talks about the conflicts faced by African Americans due to the European culture. The aim of this paper is to show how this double consciousness is still keeping on and going on in the 21st century, where the society is supposed to be literate and educated, but is also bound within the invisible chains of racism and patriarchy. The paper would also analyze the theme of double consciousness in Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye and the conflict going on within the characters like Pecola Pauline Breedlove, Sholly Breedlove, Geraldine Jr., and Sophet Church. Chloe Anthony Wofford Morrison, popularly known as Toni Morrison, was an American novelist. She was born on February 18, 1931 and died recently on August 5th, 2019. She was a specialist in the genre of American literature, and apart from being a novelist, she was also an essayist, a book editor, and a college professor. She completed her education from Howard University and Cornell University. Her first novel was The Bluest Eye, published in 1970. Her other notable works include Sula, Song of Solomon, Tar Baby, and Beloved. The Bluest Eye is the story of a little black girl, Pecola, who wishes to have blue eyes to get love from her parents, neighbors, and society. The narrator, Claudia McTee, narrates the story of Pecola Breedlove, who feels that everyone around her hates her for her dark color. She yearns for the blue eyes so that her parents, friends, and others love her the way they love white girls with blue eyes. A similar kind of hatred is faced today, even today, by the Afro-Americans. Pecola is treated badly both by white people as well as by dark people. Even her parents ill-treat her. Her mother, Pauline, hates her for being black and ugly, and her father, Charlie, who is a drunkard, abuses Pauline and Pecola emotionally, mentally, and physically. When Pecola sees that the white girls are treated very well, she feels envious and prays to God for blue eyes so that she is loved by all. In the end, she gets those blue eyes but loses her mind as a cost of it. Next is the character of Geraldine, a black, wealthy woman who only loves her cat for its cleanliness. She teaches her son Junior to play with white children and not the black ones. She explained to him the difference between colored people and niggers. They were easily identifiable. Colored people were neat and quiet. Niggers were dirty and loud. According to her, she has surpassed the criteria and belongs to the first group because she was both rich as well as neat. Junior wants to be a nigger, but is forced to behave like those white kids. He wants to play King of Mountains with his black friends, get dirty while rolling down, but is not allowed to do so. He longs for his mother's love and hates the cat. He gets so frustrated that he gets happiness by torturing black people. He calls Pecola to his house and scares her by throwing the cat on her. He enjoys seeing her afraid, and when Geraldine comes, he tells her that Pecola was trying to kill her cat. On hearing this, Geraldine gets angry and yells at Pecola. Pecola gets upset by the ill treatment she faces in the wealthy house of Geraldine. Pecola's mother, Pauline Breedler, worked as a maid in the house of Freda and Claudia. Pecola hears someone calling her mother Polly, and she gets upset as she herself calls her Mrs. Breedler very respectfully. Out of anger, she drops the boiling berry cobbler on her feet, and instead of applying any medicine on her feet, Pauline scolds and beats her for making her house even dirty. Her beauty, Pauline is herself the character, is the character who is a victim of double consciousness. Her beauty is shattered by her broken tooth and deformed foot. She feels young and beautiful when her husband Charlie makes love with her. After marriage, they go and live in a distant place. But after some time, Pauline starts hating Charlie's behavior and his blackness. She develops interest in purchasing expensive clothes and starts adoring white people. As she gets attracted to the whiteness, she starts working in the house of the white people as a maid, neglecting her house, child, and husband to remain close to the whiteness, beauty, and cleanliness. Pecola's father, Charlie Breedler, is an orphan. He was brought up by his aunt Jimmy. He is forced to make love with his girlfriend, Darlene, in front of two white men. Later, he falls in innocent love with Pauline, who likes her in the beginning, but later hates him for his dirty behavior. Further, we see Sholly become a drunkard and abuse Pauline and Pecola verbally, physically, and emotionally. He also rapes her daughter, Pecola. There is another character who misuses girls. His name is Sophet Church. He works as a priest in the church despite being a misanthrope. He misuses young girls who come to church. His attention gradually settled as those humans' bodies were least offensive. Since little boys were insulting, scary, and stubborn, he further limited his
strength. Let me conclude.
Yes, sir. During pregnancy, Pecola loses her mental stability. She was impregnated by her father, and she feels that through Sophet Church, God has granted her those blue eyes. She has an imaginary friend with whom she keeps on talking. She gets those blue eyes, but at the cost of losing her mental stability. Double consciousness is something that not only hurts the feeling and sentiment of a person, but also makes him or her go through various mental traumas. They start hating themselves and try to behave and live like the white people. The conflict of white and black is from a very long time, and instead of decreasing the percentage, it is growing day by day. The recent and another cruel incident again made us remember so. In 2019, George Floyd changed the company and joins El Nuevo Radio Club as a security guard, where police officer Derek Chauvin also worked. 2020. Yes, sir. So this was the case where the whole world was raging against, but we all know that it is something that is not going to stop anyway, and it continues, but we'll all have to stand against it and say no to racism. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nidhi. You have done a good job. And as this was a part of their internal assignment, so I give a permission to speak for a few more minutes. So now I would like to call, I would now like to request Niveda Gokuldas, guest lecturer, NSS College, Nemmara, Palakkad, Kerala, India. And the topic, okay. Niveda Gokuldas, are you there? Niveda Gokuldas, are you there?
Hello.
Please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, you're absolutely audible.
Okay. Good evening, one and all. My paper is titled as Torn Between Two Worlds, an analysis of Circe Dangaremba's nervous condition. Colonialism can be defined as a specific kind of cultural exploitation that developed with the expansion of Europe over the past 400 years. Even though this process started as a modern capitalistic system under the perception that the colonies offers various raw materials to the companies settled in Britain, soon it created a vivid hierarchy between the colonizer, the colonized in terms of race, region, culture, and color, and making the colonized the other. Postcolonialism deals with the effect of colonization on culture and society. Postcolonial literature explores the impacts of and consequences of the colonized nation. Circe Dangaremba is a celebrated Zimbabwean novelist, filmmaker, and playwright. She had penned several novels and had received several notable awards. Her novel, her debut novel, Nervous Condition, is one of the most celebrated pieces of work in African literature. Nervous Conditions is set in Rhodesia, now known as Zimbabwe, in the period of early 1970s before its independence in 1980. Nervous Condition tells us the tale of two adolescent native girls, Tambu and Naisha, and their struggle to fit into their own native culture and way of life. The title Nervous Condition is taken from Sartre's introduction to Frantz Fanon, The Wretched of the Earth. Sartre writes that, I quote, "The status of the native is a nervous condition introduced and maintained by the settler among the colonized people with their consent. One of the significant impacts of the colonization is the creation of mixed identity among the natives. The younger generation is more probable to this as they encounter the colonizer way of life and language through education, as most of the schools are set by the colonizer. Homi K. Bhabha, in his Location of Culture, says that hybridity, I quote, hybridity is a revaluation and reception of colonial identity through the reception of discriminatory identity effects. The novel, unquote, the novel Nervous Condition is narrated by Tambu Desai, a young native rural girl from Rhodesia, about her desire to get educated and to lead a better life like her uncle, Baba Mukuru, who is the headmaster of a missionary school in town. The novel opens up with the sudden demise of Tambu's brother, Naomo, and her uncle's decision to replace Naomo by Tambu at the school. Tambu is also attracted very much to the English way of life, and she also wants to be like her uncle. For her, Baba Mukuru is like a godlike figure, a savior. Apart from Tambu, the novel also tells the tale of Naisha, who is the daughter of Baba Mukuru, who was taken to Europe at infantry as Baba Mukuru got a chance to study at England. After returning from England, she tries to fit into the usual way of life, but she can't. Naisha and her elder brother have been angelized and had almost forgotten their native language, Shona. Her mother is even baffled by this. Her mother, Maiguru, tells Tambu that they don't understand Shona very well anymore and have been speaking nothing but English. Tambu is bewildered by the fact that how could one forget their own native language? When Naomo wants to speak with this Naisha, he tries to imitate them. He tries to speak in English, but with a broken accent. Mimicry describes the ambivalent term between the colonizer and the colonized. When the native tries to mimic the ways of the colonizer, the result is complex. It produces a blurred copy of the colonizer, which is threatening. According to Homi Bhabha, copying the colonizing culture, behavior, manners by the colonized contain both mockery and a menace, so that mimicry at once is a menace. Naomo is a striking example of mimicry as he begins to speak in English as soon as he leaves his homestead with Baba Mukuru when he joined the missionary school. Naomo becomes even more contemptible to the surroundings of his house and his relatives and his family. He studies hard to get into a scholarship just like his uncle, to have proper clothes and food and to live in the English way. The colonizer chooses very hardworking native and send them to study abroad so that the natives could mimic them and be their advocate among the colonized. Baba Mukuru was one among them. He uses the degree to get a job and to work as the missionary, but and also feels great to the whites who had given the opportunity for him. He is also grateful that his son Chido got an admission at a prestigious school. He is an example of an obedient native from the viewpoint of the colonizers. Even Tambu's impression is a very decent example for this. She feels that the white had given up all the comfort and sacrificed their life to come to Africa to lighten up their darkest life in Africa. Naisha, who was born in Africa and raised in England, is a crystal clear example of the caught between the two worlds. She finds it extremely discomfortable to spend time with their relatives, family, as she had forgotten most of her native language. She is also offended by the fact that women hold a second-class position in their society. The space between the two cultures is what Baba calls the liminal space, a pathway between upper and lower areas, each of which was annotated with the plaques referring to blackness and whiteness. For Baba, liminality and hybridity go hand in hand. It is an interstitial passage between fixed identification opens up to the possibility of cultural hybridity. Naisha is clearly a hybrid, a mixture of English and Rhodesian way of life. So because of that, she doesn't quite fit into the traditional Rhodesian female. A Rhodesian female is supposed to obey elders blindly and not question them. But Naisha is a rebel. Naisha doesn't conform into the traditional ways. She uses her education and knowledge to critically think about her position in the house and the position of natives in general. Naisha gets beaten up by her father and he calls him a whore for talking with a white boy. Her father asked her to talk in a certain way, to mingle in a certain way, and even to think in a certain way. Women in colonized nation are doubly colonized, first because of their race, then because of their gender. Tambu too got a chance to study because of her elder brother died. Initially, when Tambu wants to study, her father objects that women doesn't study and he won't give any money or give any financial assistance for her school. She sold meals in order to pay the school fees. Even Naisha's mother, my guru, had earned a degree from England and works as a teacher is a clear-cut example of this. Even though she has a job, she doesn't have an agency to voice her opinion. Tambu's aunt Lucia is also able to escape from patriarchy as she gets a job at missionary school and she don't have any men around her. Naisha upholds her rebellious attitude towards patriarchy. Baba Mukuru, she refuses to have food and her father forcefully feeds her food as she objects from eating it. Meanwhile, Tambu gets admission at a prestigious college run by the white nuns of England and she leaves for that. This even more scares Naisha and she gets eating disorder and she's relatively she's very thin and very skeletal. When Tambu visits Naisha during the vacation time, she explodes in front of her. She says that they have done this to us. They indicating the whites. She literally eats up the history textbook written by the colonizers and say it is worthless and spit it out. Just like she wants to spit the whiteness inside of her. Initially, Tambu was very much attracted to the English way of life. But when she takes the admission at Sacred Hearts College, she finds that the lightness that the colonizers offered to bring is a fox. She finds a separate room for the black people and they are not able to mingle with the white people. They are not equally treated in the school. And finally, she feels that the blacks will be always the other and that won't change. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you, ma'am. And now I would like to request Nivedita Raj, student of MA in English, Vasant College for Women, Varanasi. And her topic is Things Fall Apart as a Post-Colonial Counter-Narrative to Heart of Darkness, a Comparative Study. Nivedita Raj, are you there? Nivedita Raj, if you are present, please unmute yourself. Nivedita Raj.
She's not there probably, sir.
Okay. So next I would like to call, I'd like to request Oishi Chanda, MA in English, Presidency University, Kolkata. Oishi Chanda.
Good evening. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible and visible as well.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank all the organizers and the professors associated with the webinar for allowing me to act as one of the presenters today and also for encouraging our students to carry on with our academic activities even in these difficult times. So without further ado, I'd like to start talking about my paper. My paper reads as a topic, Reading Things Fall Apart as an Embodiment of Liminal Space, Igbo Worldview and Achebe's Textuality. Chinua Achebe's groundbreaking novel Things Fall Apart is a tale of the tragedy that befalls a man called Okonkwo and the Igbo community to which he belongs in the wake of the arrival of the white men on their civilizing mission. It is a powerfully telling narrative of being at the brink of ruin and at the threshold of things beginning to fall apart. Being a significant marker of post-colonial literature, the novel arguably does more than defining or exploring set characteristics. It showcases the production of newer hybrid categories of newer meanings. The colonial process itself leaves behind as remnants an amalgam of undefined brackets, which raise questions contesting essentialized notions of identity and existence. To explain this phenomena, post-colonial studies rely on the word liminal, derived from the Latin limen, meaning threshold, to refer to the in-between hybrid space in question. This paper seeks to read Things Fall Apart through a liminal perspective by exploring it at two levels, at that of the Igbo worldview and that of Achebe and his textuality. Coming to what liminality is, in his seminal text, The Location of Culture, written by Homi Bhabha, he appropriates and develops Victor Turner's concept of liminality. What is a border space to Turner becomes the realm of the beyond for Bhabha. According to him, the post-colonial perspective is not just idle speculation or mere reflection or just a form of criticism, but a process of celebrating dynamic spaces of cultural change characterized by shifting identities. Despite the context of the Afrocentric debate, which concerns a search for an essential African cultural purity, the consideration that Africa or any other post-colonial nation as such is a function and product of the West is that it is a heterogeneous mixture of components, both indigenous and foreign, invokes the very idea of liminality. A case of shifting identities and not a monolithic structure is a case for any post-colonial nation. And in this in-betweenness, this liminal perspective is the lens that we will use to read Achebe's narrative. Coming to what the Igbo community is about in this novel, the Igbo community is governed by a deep-rooted acceptance of certain rules, certain customs and belief systems, yet there is duality internalized into its personal and social fabrics. The balance which needs to be struck is at the threshold, dividing the individual and the collective, the physical and the non-physical, a man and his chi. Instances such as a character in the novel Ikemifuna, his death was preceded by the coming of the locusts. Okonkwo's youngest daughter Ezinma's sudden sickness was an indication of the ill luck that was awaiting Okonkwo, and the implicit connection of Okoli's death with the killing of the sacred python. All of these raise our attention to the duality of the physical and the non-physical world, which is clubbed into one in the Igbo psyche. The notion of chi or personal god plays an important role in the novel, whereby a man's connect with his chi or his fate acts as the governing principle of his life, yet it is not the only determinant in one's life. This calls for an understanding of Igbo metaphysics. Metaphysics can be broadly defined as an interrogation into the justification of being, especially by assuming that the physical and the non-physical worlds are related. Igbo metaphysics is a thought system which recognizes the reality and independent existence of non-physical beings and their interaction with the physical beings in a material world. Dualism in Igbo metaphysics is explained by the assumption of human beings having their counterparts in the realm of spirits. Instances such as Okonkwo breaking the week of peace by beating his youngest wife, playing a part in Ikemifuna's killing lest he be considered weak, and accidentally causing the death of Ezwedu's youngest son betray the inconsistencies which gradually lead Okonkwo to tragic circumstances. Apart from this, a tussle between Okonkwo's individual rendering of his self is often found at odds with the psyche of the community he lives by, as indicated by the warnings of the village elders. Apart from the cultural conflict the Igbos were about to face with the advent of colonialism, their own socio-political mores open up scope for us to read liminality into it. The Igbo philosophy is one that walks the tightrope between the physical and the non-physical, between the individual and his community, and between a man and his chief. Coming to the second part of my paper, Achebe's novel is a dialogue in itself about the politics of representation. As the novel ends, the 24 chapters are reduced to a minor anecdote in the district commissioner's memoir, lumped together into the essentialist category of primitive tribes. The novel is often deemed as being ethnographic for its vivid representation of Igbo customs and practices and the aura of authenticity which surrounds it. Achebe is positioned as a native anthropologist who provides an insider's view to his subject matter. But an entirely ethnographic reading of a literary text almost always undermines its aesthetic worth and furthers the assumption that ethnographic texts are transparent, that they unproblematically represent history, which is not true. Ethnographic observations can be problematized if only one looks at the observer-observed relationship as a complex one, in this case especially as Achebe himself was one who lived at the crossroads of two cultures. He was an insider with a certain amount of distance as well. Achebe's father had adopted Christianity. Achebe had received colonial education at secondary school and at the University of Ibadan, becoming one of the select elite, highly educated West Africans. In Things Fall Apart, Achebe appears to be carrying out what James Clifford has called a project of ethnographic salvage, and I quote him, but it is essentially a recreation of the life which is spoken about in a historical fiction. Thus, Achebe himself being a divided subject, his subjectivity lying within the liminal zone of two cultures, his text always resists a simplistic reading, not only in its status as post-colonial literature, but also in its status as a fictionalized historical narrative. Liminality is observed at various points in the textual narrative, where the narrator is at times the omniscient third-person voice who can look deep into the Igbo psyche and is at times a skeptical non-believer. He's also a non-participating author in these cases. The narratorial voice shifts in and out of the two zones, allowing fluid movements between varied frames of references. For example, in chapter 2, the narrator says, darkness held a vague terror for these people, whereby he is otherizing the Igbo people from himself. Then when speaking of Agbala, the oracle of the hills and the caves, the narrator does not proclaim disbelief overtly, but the existence of Agbala is left in question. During a communal ceremony, it is mentioned that the women in the crowd might have noticed the second ancestral spirit having the springy walk of Okonkwo, and that Okonkwo was not present among the audience, thus alerting readers to the uncertainties which may engender doubts in one's mind. Achebe's use of language too verges on the border separating two registers. With intermittent use of Igbo words, he succeeds in making claims to authentic representation and attests to the complexity of the cultural translation that he attempts. He tells the story of an indigenous native tribe in a foreign tongue. As several critics have argued, Achebe indigenizes the English language, reproducing attributes of African oral tradition in a written text. One could also say, and I quote again, he seeks to reproduce the structure of native discourse within an alien language. So this liminal space that Achebe's novel occupies between two cultural discourses, both in form and content, between proximity and distance, between ethnography and historicity, thus stand out as critical registers to analyze his work. I come to my conclusion. The post-colonial condition raises cultural crucial issues, of identity and selfhood. And it must be understood that post-coloniality renders any homogeneous monolithic classification impossible. Post-colonial identities are heterogeneous fluid categories which exist only in in-betweenness in liminal spaces. Achebe explores this trope of his work in his work owing to his vantage point of being one in between, slipping in and out of the margins. Be it the cultural practices of unified binaries embedded deep in the Igbo psyche, the gradual dissipation of the older orders in the wake of the colonial rule, the politics of language incorporated into the text, or the lenses used to read the text, the idea of liminality holds water throughout. Achebe himself said, living between two worlds is one of the central themes of my life and work. Even Okonkwo's suicide, with which the novel ends, is an act of defiance and submission at once. A tragic tale of human endurance and an exploration of the cultural mores of the Igbo people, Things Fall Apart, stands out as one of the most poignant novels of the 20th century. It reclaims history and reconstructs it, stitching it together with the hybrid heterogeneous spaces, psychological or otherwise. As Achebe has said, it is the storyteller who makes us what we are, who creates history. The storyteller creates the memory that survivors must have, otherwise their surviving would have no meaning. Possibly all quests undertaken by mankind are eventually those looking for meaning, and meaning often escapes through fractures in between categories. Things Fall Apart alerts us gently to those in-between categories,
nuanced,
loaded, and overlooked, lest our quest for meaning fails us. I hope I have not exceeded the time limit.
Thank you, Oishi, for this lovely paper.
Thank you.
And next, I would like to call P. Steffi Monisha. I would like to request P. Steffi Monisha, student of MA in English Literature, Stella Maris College. And her topic is Intersection of Postcolonialism and Gender in Adichie's Purple Hibiscus.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay, you're audible. You can start your presentation.
Yes, sir. Sir, are you able to see my PPT?
Yes, you can see it.
Yeah. So, good evening, everyone. I'm Steffi, a second MA student of Stella Maris College. Today, I'll be presenting my paper titled Intersection of Postcolonialism and Gender in Adichie's Purple Hibiscus. Purple Hibiscus is a building drama novel written by the Nigerian author Adichie in the year 2003. It is remarkable that a postcolonial building drama like Purple Hibiscus showcases the socio-cultural identity of the colonized during the political turmoil of Nigeria in the 1990s. Analyzing post-colonial Nigeria using the archetype of a young girl, Kambali, is significant as it narrates the disintegration of her family unit, which reflects the unstable condition of the country and her struggle to evolve as a mature being. This paper attempts to explore the intersection of post-colonialism and gender in Purple Hibiscus by focusing on a narrative style, setting, and how one family's private struggle extends into a political metaphor. The novel is initially set in Enugu, a post-colonial town where Kambali lives with her parents, Eugene and Beatrice, and her brother, Jaja. Even though Eugene's house in Enugu was a luxury that could not be afforded by many Nigerians, the reader can sense it is gloomy. Kambali describes the yard as being wide enough for 100 dancers to do somersaults, but the readers can feel that it is imbued with a sense of entrapment. The high compound walls were topped by coiled electric wires. This depiction is paradoxical, as the house is well guarded from harms of the external world, but is unprotected from the physical violence inflicted by her own father. Okeade explains that this tyranny, in an allegorical way, emulates the succession of Nigerian dictatorship. Okeade states, I quote, Eugene's home becomes a microcosm of the entire Nigerian nation, unquote. This image of the home becoming an alien territory due to oppression is very symbolic of colonization. After an incident of Beatrice being brutally beaten by Eugene, the children watch as he slings her limp body over his shoulder, dripping blood all the way. They have become desensitized to this kind of violence and aggression and therefore remain silent, emotionless, and afraid. Kiari explains that this inclusion of silence, most particularly that of companies, in relation to Eugene's patriarchal tyranny, becomes a significant motif in the novel. On another occasion, Eugene discovers that the children overstayed their visit at their grandfather's house by 10 minutes and punishes them by pouring scalding hot water over their legs. Kambali remains silent throughout her punishment because she's terrified of her father, but starts screaming in pain once he leaves the room. This symbolizes how language is rendered powerless because of the anxiety caused by what Foucault calls the panoptic gaze. However, Eugene does not seem to feel guilty for his inhumane actions as he justifies that he is punishing them for their own sins. This kind of atrocious violence is treated with a frighteningly casual attitude in the novel. Beatrice remains loyal and submissive to Eugene despite the domestic violence because he does not take another wife. Here we can see Beatrice's psychological state as a wife reflects Simone de Beauvoir's statement in Second Sex. I quote, "She, that is the woman, is in the essential in front of the essential, that is the man," end quote. This psychological and physical repression of being the other ultimately culminates when she ends up poisoning Eugene. Papa Enoku, who is Eugene's father, lives in Aba, a village predominantly Igbo in ethnicity. Eugene refuses to take care of him because his father has not converted to Christianity and accuses him of being a pagan. Eugene lives lavishly while Papa Enoku suffers physically from ailments and he has no money to even buy his medicines. Regarding this Martin remarks, I quote, "Adichie has skillfully constructed a clear tension between the privileged positionality afforded to conservative Christian followers and the inferior positionality of traditionalists," unquote. Hence, we can see that Eugene here is the embodiment of the colonizer's Christianity, while Papa Enoku represents the colonized Igbo. Auntie Ifeoma, a sibling of Eugene, and her flat in Nsukka is of vital importance as it is a space which leads to major transformation in the lives of the children. When visiting her auntie in Nsukka, Kambali often finds herself stuttering or giving muffled replies to any questions addressed to her. Hewitt, in finding her voice, expresses that Kambali has become so paralyzed by the fear of her father that she struggles to even speak about the most mundane of things. Unlike Beatrice, her mother, she sees that Auntie Ifeoma is an outspoken woman who is unafraid to criticize her own brother, the university, or even the Nigerian government. Kambali becomes conscious of how her auntie treats her own children with respect, encouraging them to speak their minds, which is in total contrast with her father's rigid discipline. Ultimately, we see it is that Aunt Ifeoma who helps both Jaja and Kambali to find their voices. Kiarni observes that this connotation of Adichie's deliberate choice of a woman to become the crucial agent of Kambali's and Jaja's progress. The complexity of the situation is constructed on the premise of Kambali's pride in her father Eugene. Though elated by his charitable acts, it is her fear of humiliation that dominates her narrative. Being a girl, she is more vulnerable than Jaja to the manipulation by male power. Thus, we can see Kambali's oppression is a product of the intersection of multiple factors such as age, religion, gender, and physical violence. Kambali's silence arises chiefly from her unspoken feelings of anguish and indignation at her father's cruel behavior as a result of his transformation as a colonial product. This can be seen because even though he is Nigerian, he apes the West in his clothing and believes that white people do everything better. For instance, he has more admiration for Father Benedict, who speaks English, than Father Amari, who is a native and preaches in Igbo. He speaks mostly in English and avoids speaking his native tongue of Igbo unless he is very angry. On the other hand, his sister Ifeoma is of course frustrated by the corruption in Nigeria, but she still believes that the country should embrace its own resources and independence. Post-colonialism is viewed through two different lenses through these two individuals. Nsukka, the town where Ifeoma lives, ultimately becomes a symbol of liberty for Kambali and Jaja, as it is here they enter a new world of freedom. Though the plot of Purple Hibiscus unfolds mostly on a personal level, larger political background influences the lives of these characters. From Kambali's perspective, we can understand the relevance of Auntie Ifeoma's flat at Nsukka because for her, it is this space that unifies the private and political spheres of Nigeria. After Papa's death, Kambali attains physical liberation, but it is the liberation of her mind that actually matters. The greatest challenge of the novel is portraying the transformation of the young girl Kambali, who was a silenced agent, to someone who fearlessly narrates the history of post-colonial Nigeria through her personal experience. Adichie does this by using the character of Kambali, who learns to articulate what Hewitt in his article calls the different silence of the present. I would like to conclude by thanking the organizer, the chairperson, and all of you for patiently listening to my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Peace Steffi Manisha, for this wonderful presentation. And now I would like to call, I would like to request Rajat Subramandal. Rajat Subramandal, doctoral research scholar, Department of English, Raiganj University, West Bengal, India. Mr. Mandal.
Thank you. Thank you, Jadjit sir. I'm still overwhelmed by your paper on Beloved. Thank you to the collaborating universities from Africa Bangladesh and elsewhere. And thank you, Rishi Bolkinjani, for letting me present my talk. My paper is on Black Queer Lives Matter. Basically, I would be talking about case Rodriguez's take on Childs to Pride. We have been talking about Black Lives Matters, but we haven't been talking enough about hashtag Black Queer Lives Matter, because it also does matter. Anyway, and Cello Duikers, the quiet violence of dreams, colors the spiting of genre, gender, facts, fiction, sexuality, sanity, sacredness, and the profane with a shade of my favorite color, rainbow. It brings the bildungsroman of a Black gay young man named Shepo Angelo to Epuria. The novel is bildungsroman that narrativizes the coming out of Shepo Angelo. He is medicalized, disciplined in a mental asylum. I'm not using quotation because my entire paragraph is in pink fluorescent quotation. and his father, who happens to be an unadulterated embodiment of patriarchy, writes history of family violence, rape, and murder. It constructs the discourse Shepo's perverse implantation, as Foucault would say. The African society is the macrocosm of what happens in the family of Shepo. The body politics of Shepo becomes the outcome of African homophobia that binarizes deviants from others. The homophobia that tries to keep mainstream Africa pure, again in quotation, defiance and perverts that could be panopticonized and medico-juridically attended to under state surveillance. The biopolitics of state ideology sells Shepo absolutely down the river. Now, Cello Duikers has counterintuitively collapsed madness into sexuality. Madness is narrativized as Shepo Angelo's passport into discoveries of his sexuality. So what I'm trying to say is that madness can be productive in terms of helping you explore all those alternative sexualities that heteronormativity doesn't necessarily allow you to explore. So his madness problematizes the dialogism between mind and body. He begins to menstruate only to blur the gendered hierarchy even further. This gender trouble ruffles all the feathers of Shepo for his job as a male prostitute at Steamy Windows, a massage parlor in South Africa. At the parlor, he is thrown into the deep in between the mysterious world of sex, gender, and sexuality, and the dynamics of power. Now, it was interspersed with the reference of pre-Raphaelite brotherhood. The perception of sexuality of the male sex workers owes a lot to pre-Raphaelite brotherhood, drag queen Sebastian. And I'm quoting a little bit section from the novel. In so-called primitive societies, a man, even a boy, knows what he is doing when he puts his penis inside a woman. And the woman too, they are aware of themselves, of how weak they are against a man's strength and how to use sex in their favor. What I am trying to say is that so-called primitive African people understand gender roles and the ambiguities of sexualities better than Western people give them credit for, right? And people always say that Black cultures is rigid, is inflexible, and they do not accept the lesbians, the radical lesbians, the homosexuals. You know what? You know, it's the one country that doesn't accept it. It's the British, the great Victorians. And you know, the argument, it's absolutely un-African. Long ago, the Africans were aware of these alternative sexualities. Now, homosexuality was criminalized, pathologized, medicalized by the whites, because the supply line of docile body had to be continued, and that's why the population would not grow, and obviously the capitalism and the industrialization would not continue. So we know the game. The pre-colonial past of Africa has always already been queer. The theoretical entanglement of post-colonial queer of Cello Duikers novel destabilizes and rejects the traditional sex gender desire teleology, as Judith Butler would always say. And Chepo fails or refuses to fit into the gendered ontology of man-woman, homosexual, heterosexual binaries. Now, I do not like to use the third gender. Why? It's because the third gender somehow maintains a hierarchy from first gender to second gender to third gender. So every time I say third gender, I am hierarchizing first gender and second gender. So therefore, what I am going to say, instead of saying the third gender, the alternative gender, instead of numerically diagonizing and the categorizing in the digitalizing the genders along those lines of Western epistemology. So colonial Africa pigeonholed bodies as intelligible category in order for bodies to be identified as culturally recognizable. Docile bodies must conform to either of those boxes, like homosexual and heterosexual. Once those boxes are ticked, right, the friendship amongst the patriarchy, colonialism and capitalism grows from strength to strength. And body of Chepo and Angelo and Sebastian become a site of gender identity that is spurious, erudite, and sometimes esoteric as well. Now, there's another little quotation from the text. I'm changing, I'm evolving. My body is changing, my body has started menstruating. Now, these are the things that Chepo wrote a letter to his dead mother. And Chepo mistakes menstruation for quote-unquote madness. And in the numerous letters that he writes to her dead mother, as part of Bildungsroman, he begins to come to terms with the epiphanic realization that there is not much difference between men and women. And Chepo identifies with female bodies. They are both bearers and lovers of children. They are the unpaid caretakers. And Chepo's sex and gender anti-teleology subverts the grand narrative of what we call biology is destiny. And his unstable body is the site of critique of the sacrosanct privilege of science as the monopolist repository of truth and Western epistemology. Now, being a real man is hinged on the possession of a number of beautiful female sexual partners, the size of the penis, and the sexual virility. Now, these barometers of manhood are positioned in such a way that men who fall outside these categories, these barometers, such as men who do not desire women, such as men who do not like marriage or heterosexual monogamy, such as men who do not participate in promiscuity, they are othered. They are men. They are not men. But there's interesting thing that patriarchy does. And I always say patriarchy is a kind of a drug-resistant coronavirus. You know, it's something that men who are, yes, the vaccine is the name of the vaccine. I don't know what Russia has discovered. The name of the vaccine of the patriarchy is queer theory. Yes. And the discovery is very much on in India. And men who are not promiscuous, not interested in sexual ventures and the conquest of female bodies, who do not dominate women, are tolerated, right, by hegemonic masculinity because they do not hurt patriarchy. Wow. Males who like penises rather than vaginas are made outlaws. Men who love other men end up as objects of homophobic rage because such love disturbs, right? Disturbs the cornerstone of patriarchal heterosexual power, in that it shows that men are not the same mind feeling when it comes to sexuality. Now, I have a little point here. Now, I'm sorry for the women present here, but there are trillions and billions and millions of women who are more patriarchal than we men. And when we talk about toxic masculinity, let's talk about toxic femininity. And in order for us to understand toxic femininity, I think queer theory has got a very good friend in feminist theories. If they are not befriending with feminist theories, the queer theory or vice versa, I think patriarchy, like coronavirus, would be smiling from Wuhan. Now, coming to the end of the paper, I won't bore people to death. Okay, and so I'm concluding my paper. So K. Selo Duikers
depicts that gay men, and very importantly relevant to contemporary societies, Sebastian points out that unlike heterosexual married men who are exhausted by various familial responsibilities, gay men have a great deal of energy because they do not have energy to spend on their children, on their wives. So gay men have plenty of energy and sometimes to present paper in colleges, and they use their energy to plow back to ailing economies and civilizations. K.S. Eloduiker's novel, The Quiet Violence of Dreams, is a pioneering South African novel to create a black gay protagonist whose quest for identity eventually brings him to see his homosexuality as an inalienable part of African identity, right? Now, this is interesting. The Quiet Violence Dreams is a rhizomatic structure. Every time I say rhizome, I talk about Giles Deleuze and Felix Guattari's Thousand Plateaus, and of Shepo, who become merely a black stallion or exotic angelo. He is no longer the son or brother to other gay men, which he might have imagined himself to be. The sense of exclusion and exploitation which Shepo experiences can be read as representative of how black queer voices are seen out of place in mainstream queer culture of South Africa. Every time we talk about Africa, we talk about racism, but we don't realize that there is another layer of exploitation, that the homosexuals are even marginalized within the marginalized. So they are twice colonized for the same offense. Incredible. That's why we say Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. How often do you say Black Queer Lives Matter? Never. Wow. Congratulations to all of your homophobia. And gay desire is presented as a liberation from aggressive heteronormative masculinity and opportunity for the redefinition of entire rubric of Africanness. It blurs the boundaries of gender, gender facts and fiction, sexuality and everything. Now, the advent of colonialism and Christianity, I'm using Christianity as a synonym for colonialism, for obviously the reason everybody knows, twisted the ways in which pre-colonial African cultures viewed sexuality and masculinity construction. Duiker's juxtaposition of the past and the present uses the past to look at the present with an eye to dismantling homophobia camouflaged in corpophobia and Western morality. And this involves intertwining homosexuality with the spiritual realm through the use of mythopoeia. Now, that's why I say spirituality is queer and religion is patriarchal. And since religion has always already been patriarchal and spirituality has always already been queer, and that's why I think queer theory is not invented from America, by the way. It has always already been Indian, right? And the queer and the quiet violence of the dreams offer subversive counter-narratives to widespread homophobia, counter-narratives that probably declares, as the flag behind me shows, the black queer lives matter. Thank you for tolerating me.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Rajat Subramandal.
And I have something to say, that Devdeep sir, I am still recovering from your paper. Your paper on Beloved has absolutely left me mesmerized. And I said that in the live chat. And thank you for your paper on Beloved. Maybe we'll get in touch soon.
Sure. You're a very, very good teacher indeed. And your way, your unconventional way of teaching and delivering lecture reminds me of Dr. Niladri Chatterjee. Thank you so much. You took me back to my PG days. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
So now I would request Raka Mukherjee, student of MA in English Literature, Loreto College, Kolkata, to kindly present the paper.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, so first of all, I'd like to congratulate everyone who has presented today, and I'd like to thank the organizers. Before I begin with my paper, I believe it's the last paper for today. So before I begin the paper, I would like to request Devdeep sir, that if I do go a minute or two overboard, then please type it on the chat box and I'll keep an eye on the chat box and then I'll round it up. So may I begin?
Yeah.
Okay. is my PPT visible?
Not yet. Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay, so my paper is Voices of the Fair Sex in Literature of the Dark Continent, locating and analyzing the depiction of doubly colonized women in the novels of African and African-American authors. The Dark Continent is neither dark nor unexplorable, remarked Helene Sissou in her essay, The Laugh of the Medusa. Detaching the idea of women as the embodiment of the geographical space of Africa, this paper attempts to analyze the muffled voices and actions of the women in selected works of African and African-American literature. In this paper, I argue that the actions of these women, when analyzed against their social, economic, and cultural background, throw light on the collective voice of the African and African-American woman, who is bound to be complicit to patriarchal oppression, yet wishes to break through limitations by forming her own space of liberty and free will. I'd like to begin with a poem. Pampered sister titillates herself to frenzy with chaotic tales of male exploitation. I, dumb black woman, laughed mirthlessly on flicking away tears of pain from eyes. Nkiru Nzegbu's poem Sisterhood evokes the dual dynamics of African feminism's binary of sisterhood and motherhood and colonial othering of the oppressed black woman by the white sisters carrying the white woman's burden. In her introduction to African feminisms, Desiree Lewis remarked that authors like Pumla Jikola and Amina Mama raise important questions about the perspectives subsumed by African feminism and pinpoint patterns that include the Africa diaspora divide, differences in naming ourselves as womenists, black feminists, African feminists, as well as varying forms of engagement with Western feminism. The novels under analysis are predominantly set in the Igbo community and portray customs of the Igbo society in detail pertaining to the changing times. The two major traditions which Igbo women have been, in my opinion, repeatedly exposed to in the name of communal discipline and cultural legacy are deification and reification of the African mothers and daughters, respectively. Deification, or the act of elevating an entity or human being to the level of God, has been a common practice in the Igbo community. Their life and beliefs revolve around their chi, or the personal god of luck, and a compendium of other heathen gods and goddesses, two of which will be our blueprint to recognize the feminine impulse and embodiment of the deities into the characters in African literature. The goddess of Earth, or Ani, plays a pivotal role in Chinua Achebe's seminal novel, Things Fall Apart. In this novel, the protagonist Okonkwo commits several acts of crime, which includes domestic violence against his wife for a nominal mistake, murder of his adopted son Ike Mifuna, and finally committing suicide after killing the white man's messenger. And this he commits against the Earth goddess. Although the Igbo society respects the masculine oppression in order to keep the women of the community under control, there are a few restricted months of peace where no violence is tolerated and the mother goddess Ani's rage is feared, as equivocated by the village elder Oberika. It is the kind of action in which the goddess wipes out families. The Mother Earth, Ani or Ala, here becomes the manifestation of all the muted voices that were oppressed by the heathen chief, ranging from his three wives, his adopted son, his daughter, and his elder son, who the mother goddess refuses to accept the evil body, and Okonkwo is not invited back to her womb. Okpu Ukalu, in his paper, remarked that Allah was once supreme before Igwe started a typically male campaign to usurp, that Igwe ka Allah depicts an oracular version of this period of intense rivalry. Owerongke Oweyumi, in her introduction to African women and feminism, talks about the role of sisterhood through motherhood in the Igbo culture. The most profound sisterly relations are to be found in co-mothering, which is the essence of community building. Florin Wapa, in her novel Ifuru, embodies the late goddess of fertility Uhamiri into the person of her titular protagonist. This novel significantly elaborates the barren deity Uhamiri's blessings of fecundity through the struggles of Ifuru,
who, in likeness of the goddess, is only able to mother a single child but later becomes infertile. The indomitable force of the image of the lake goddess could perhaps be best explicated by Dr. Bijalpita Mehta's argument in her dissertation, Unchaste Goddesses. The impulse to subjugate the feminine emerges from a fear of the feminine flood that would destabilize the masculinist project to contain and dominate. The importance of motherhood in the African society is directly showcased through Noapa's pen. In spite of Ifuru's resilience to societal oppression, her arid womb becomes a reason for her humiliation, even by her apparently educated husband Gilbert, who questions the power of the deity. However, her self-identification and acceptance becomes the loudest voice of silent resistance by worshipping the deity, and the identity of womanhood is successfully detached from the idea of motherhood with the question, she had never experienced the joy of motherhood. Why then did women worship her? This question is ironically answered by Buchi Emecheta through her novels, The Joys of Motherhood, which is preceded by The Bright Price, where the reification of daughters and wives through marriage is derisively criticized. Inu Igo, the protagonist of The Joys of Motherhood, mirrors Ifuru in transcending into the deity in death, to whose spirits the people wish for children. However, the irony lies in the fact that Inu Igo throughout her life had born several children, yet failed to enjoy the joys of motherhood. The trajectory of the novel degenerates her identity to a womb bearing multiple children. She almost becomes a device for fertility. Inu Igo had it all, yet still did not answer prayers for children. Emecheta's The Bright Price exposes the economic exploitation and commodification of women through marriage. Ingrained deep in Nigerian marriage customs exists the practice of paying the bride price or a dowry while bringing palm wine to the bride's father by the groom's family in order to ask for a hand in marriage. This assigns a transactional value to the bride and assigns her ownership to the groom and his family. In this novel, Akuna, a teenage girl of the Nigerian household, along with her mother, Ma Blackie, is inherited as wife and daughter by her uncle on her father's sudden demise. The ontological significance of Akuna's name, literally translating to father's wealth, reinstates the dehumanization of women to material wealth to be inherited by the father of the house. Akuna's tragic fate in the novel is almost an attempt to satirize the tragic life of Igbo women when they are not complicit to the patriarchal oppression. Akuna's decision to marry her lower caste Osu lover Chike, and thereby defiance of her uncle's wishes to claim a high bride price in exchange of her hand in marriage, is her claim of liberty in living like a human being who makes her own choices instead of being property to be inherited by the powers of the patriarch. However, Emecheta decided to not only punish her defiance by killing her through childbirth, but also to eulogize the Igbo superstition to the level of mockery. If you want to live a long time, your bride price must be paid. Of course, safe birth does not depend on a bride price, but even today, no girl wants to risk it. The complexity of double consciousness was introduced by W.E.B. Du Bois in his Strivings of the Negro People, where he portrayed the psychological duality of the post-colonial African-American. This longing to attain a self-conscious manhood, to merge his double self into a better and truer self. In No Longer at Ease, 1960, Clara's complicity to sacrifice her relationship in spite of receiving formal education and Ifuru and Tashi's acceptance of getting their bodies circumcised leaves a haunting odor of complicity in Ifuru and The Color Purple, respectively. The colonial blessing of formal education could not eradicate the heathen roots of caste system that was entrenched in them. Alice Walker's The Color Purple raises the voice of womanist sisterhood by adopting the colonial tongue and writing the epistolary accounts to God and to each other while fighting the patriarchal oppression by the black man of white values. Walker's linguistic distortion of the colonial language to uncomfortable rhetoric, obfuscating spelling and expression, burst open the channels of pain that muffled and deprived voice of Seeley gushes through. Similarly, Nettie's patience to write letters, in spite of her brother-in-law's refusal to pass them on, throw light on defiance and endurance that lay in the roots of feminine complicity. The white woman's sympathy shapes the black feminist act of infanticide by Sete in Toni Morrison's Beloved, born into slavery, lucky enough to not be discarded like her mother and grandmother by the white woman. Sete's act of resistance lay in learning the sanctimony of the white woman and exploiting the black sister as object of labor. The right of the black woman to own her breast milk is expropriated by the sons of the white sister. The little white baby's got it first, and I got what was left. There was no nursing milk to call my own. Sethe refused to let her beloved daughter become offering to the white man's whims. To conclude, and Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak observed, the subaltern cannot speak. There is no virtue in global laundry lists with women as a pious item. What subliminal thought that years of dehumanizing through cultural deification and communal reification had resulted in was the actions of the oppressed black women of the Dark Continent to reclaim their identity as humans in the complex maze of double consciousness and complicity. It is perhaps safe to conclude that the subaltern can definitely act in their limited space, subtle yet effective and personal, which ultimately becomes the collective voice of revolt against patriarchy of the man and sisterarchy of the white woman. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Raka Mukherjee, for presenting such a wonderful paper. And now, I think it's time to call Mr. Mondal again to answer those questions. Mr. Mondal, are you there?
Yes, I am alive. Yes.
So, it's time to answer your question.
Yes, I would have answered, but I just found tiny number of 10 million questions. So I couldn't answer. So, I couldn't answer them. Okay, I don't know whether they love me or they are kind of hating me, but there are too many questions. Okay, which one should I answer? Anyone that you want?
Anyone. Choose anyone.
Okay. Okay. Okay, I saw that. Is there any? Okay, I'm answering a couple of them. Okay. Is that okay, Devdeep sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's absolutely okay.
Okay, I thought there was a question that was asking me, is there any difference between sex? What is the difference between sex and gender? Okay, my answer is the difference between sex and gender is that there is no difference between sex and gender. Yes, this is a very important answer. The difference between sex and gender is that there is no difference between sex and gender. Both are fictions. And sex is not biological. Sex is as much cultural product as gender is. But I cannot explain this because it would be end of August if I start answering this. Okay. I am answering one more probably if Devdeep Shah doesn't throw me out. Okay. What is toxic femininity? Okay, I think there is a girl who has directed the question to me. What is toxic femininity? Yes, we have seen Kabir Singh, and that movie was labeled toxic masculine. But have you seen that lovely movie called Mardani? I think that movie is a celebration of toxic femininity. Okay, that is not going to be solving the problem. Now, what is toxic femininity? The thought that feminism is only about women is troublesome. Why? Because as Judith Butler has said, that one is not born a woman, one becomes a woman. Who will guarantee that one is not a male? Who will guarantee that one is not a male? If RSM, Roger Subramandal, is born a woman but does not become a woman, what if I say? Right? So therefore, feminism needs to be careful in not alienating men who are non-hegemonic into their rubric. And feminism would be a disaster. I'm sorry, girls, I have to break your heart. Feminism would be a disaster because you are not collaborating with queer theorists. Because if you don't, then feminism would face the consequences that feminism is facing. And patriarchy. Patriarchy is a drug-resistant, absolutely kind of a coronavirus that keeps updating itself with everything. So if women do not understand the need to collaborate with those men who are not hegemonic, the men who are not dominant masculinity, otherwise feminism would be counterproductive. Okay, for the heck of the students, I'm answering one more, last one, okay? And then I think I'm done. Just a minute, Devdeep sir. Okay, how does, this is my favorite one actually. How does a child become pride in your title? Yes, my title was Black Queer Lives Matter, and the title, I saw that KSL Duika Chides to Pride. Okay, lovely. Do you know what does queer mean? I think the question was directed from a girl called Aditi. Do you know what queer means? Queer means someone who is strange. In Bengali, kemon kemon chi. So what we have done, the queer theorists, we have taken the abuse and turned it athwart, as Eve Kosovsky said, you could say. And having turned it athwart, what we have done, we have taken the abuse. Okay, tomra amake gali galas dite chao to. Okay, I am taking this as a compliment. Now I am taking queer as a compliment and turning it against you. Now patriarchy doesn't know, like a guerrilla war, who is attacking me, right? I am not supporting you. I am not opposing you. This is my position. Unlike the feminists, this is my position. So patriarchy, much like America, doesn't know where the bunkers, the trenches are in Iraq. So that's where Eve Kosovsky Sedgwick's through athwart, the theory of athwart would come into play. And initially it was begun as a child, the queer, Bhatshona in Bengali. And then what we have done, we have converted into a pride, a rainbow march. Thank you. I think I'm done.
Thank you, Mr. Mondal.
Welcome.
You have been a wonderful speaker. And so I think we are done. So I would like to thank each and everyone who participated in this webinar, and it's really a pleasure for us. It gives me immense pleasure when I find speakers like Mr. Mondal, Raka, and everyone. They presented their paper in such a way, I just loved it. And thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of this grand webinar. Thank you for being a part of this international webinar. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, all the participants, and Devdeep Banerjee, for your time. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. We'll call off today.